Good evening. You're watching Primetime Debate. I'm Tamanna Inamdar. A 14-year-long wait is over. India has finally got a sovereign rating upgrade. Moody's Investor Services raised India's sovereign rating to Baa2 from Baa3, citing continued progress in the nation's economic and institutional reforms. Moody's Mary Duron said that the impact of reforms will materialize in the coming years.
We upgraded India's rating to Baa2 and changed the outlook to stable. And that reflects our vision that over time, the reforms that have been implemented, are being implemented, will support India's economic strength and shock absorption capacity. And with that and a large domestic financing base for the government's debt, then we see stability here in India's credit metrics at a Baa2 level.
So what are the factors that led to the change of heart by Moody's, and what will be the implications of the upgrade? Our banking and economy editor Ira Dugal explains the impact in this report.
The rating upgrade is premised on the long-term view that Moody's is taking on India and its structural reforms, because none of them have started to pay dividends yet, but Moody's expects them to. So some of the key reforms that are cited by Moody's as reasons for this upgrade, or the factors that underpin this upgrade, include the goods and services tax, the improvement to the monetary policy framework, where we are now a flexible inflation targeting country. Measures to address the overhang of bad loans through the recapitalization of state-owned banks has also been seen as a key reform measure, demonetization, Aadhaar, the move towards direct benefit transfers, and the planned labor and land reforms, which haven't fully been announced yet, but are in the works, are all factors that Moody says could actually help improve, enhances the word they use, India's growth potential, and also the stability of India's government finances. Now, post this upgrade, you want to look at where we are in terms of other emerging markets. We've just taken the BRICS as an example. You could take any investment class or any sort of emerging market class, but in the BRICS countries, China of course remains the top notch. After that, it's India, South Africa, Russia and Brazil in that order. So you do get a little bit of a bump up within the EM space in terms of being slightly higher rated, at least as by Moody's. Remember, the two other rating agencies, S&P and Fitch, have not yet moved on India's rating. They've talked about the structural reforms that they think will pay dividends, but I think the one thing that they haven't explained properly is whether their view on India's debt dynamics have changed. For the longest time, rating agencies have cited the fact that India has a relatively high debt to GDP ratio as one reason why its rating could not be upgraded. Now, remember, there has been no change in that debt dynamic. So the question being asked is, has Moody's changed the way it looks at debt to GDP? Just to give you a sense, India's debt to GDP is at 68.7%. Moody's in their release said that the median in this rating class is 44%. But if you look at the individual countries within that rating class, there's wide divergence. Italy has a very high debt to GDP of 133%, and then Oman and Philippines have much lower debt to GDPs as India. So perhaps there is some change in the way at least Moody's looks at the debt to GDP ratio. It says that it expects India's debt to GDP ratio to remain stable and reduce gradually over a period of time. The other thing it does not clearly explain is whether it has changed its view on India's low per capita income, but they do talk about the fact that structurally the potential for growth could improve because of all of the structural reforms. Now, I guess on a day like this, the big question is, what does this all mean? What does a rating upgrade really do? Well, unfortunately, it doesn't do a whole lot. It does something on the margin. So any company which is borrowing overseas in dollars or doing rupee-denominated debt in the overseas markets, they could see their spreads come down a little bit, meaning essentially that they could borrow at slightly cheaper rates. There could be some increase in inflows into the domestic debt markets as well, but we don't have too much limit in terms of the FI caps on domestic debt, so that would be slightly muted. And then the final thing, and perhaps the most important thing, is that it's just a mood booster. It's a mood booster towards India in the overseas markets, and it's a mood booster towards reforms in the domestic market. That essentially sums up the rating action today and its impact.
Well, that big booster also extends politically to some extent, or does it, is the big question. Now, over the last few weeks, there has been a surge of good news for the Bharatiya Janata Party. India jumped up in the ease of doing business rankings. Then there was a Pew survey which said 9 out of 10 Indians have a lot of trust in their Prime Minister. His popularity is the same as it was 3 years ago, and now there's been a Moody's upgrade. Why is this important? Perhaps because after a long time, the opposition party has made the economic handling by the central government as a key election plank and a key focus point to criticize the Narendra Modi government and by proxy the Bharatiya Janata Party, who is fighting for re-elections in Gujarat. So to speak about these implications, I'm joined this evening by A.K. Bhattacharya. He's editorial director of Business Standard, political analyst Shankar Iyer, and in a bit we'll be speaking with Praveen Chakravarti, who's contributing editor at Bloomberg Quint. Welcome to all of you. Mr. Bhattacharya, I'm going to start with you. You know, a little while earlier, I spoke with Piyush Goyal and I asked him, how much does this help you in Gujarat? And he said that the people of Gujarat were already keen to vote for us, etc. And, you know, what you'd expect an answer from a union minister from the ruling party. But how much of a difference does it really make, and has it effectively derailed the entire opposition plank, which says that GST and demonetization was a double tap to the heart of the economy?
Well, you know, it doesn't derail the opposition plan in my view, but it definitely offers them a speech-making opportunity. It gives the ruling party some very powerful talking points. After all, as you mentioned, the ease of doing business, the PU survey, you have the Moody's rating upgrade. Now these are all signs of an economic policy environment improvement. So it does give an opportunity to the ruling party representatives in the electoral debates in Gujarat to say that we have managed the economy well, and Gujarat is one of the most industrialized states in the country. So in the backdrop of the problems that the state went through demonetization and GST, these will come as scoring points in a debate. So to that extent, I think it will have an impact. It will help the opposition's arguments. Whether it actually, clinches the electoral battle for the BJP, is difficult to say at this point in time, because there's so many other factors: agricultural, rural distress, the impact of the GST, the rate system. All those factors will be at play. So for the moment, it gives you a feel-good factor. As your correspondent Ira Dogal said, it will definitely boost the mood. So, which is, in my view, is a positive for the BJP.
So it is a positive for the BJP, Shankar. But again, I bring that question to you. And the reason why I'm saying is that if the Congress today and Rahul Gandhi in rally after rally in Gujarat says that GST has, been disastrous for the trade and for various sectors in Gujarat. Today you have a Moody's survey which says that GST and its implementation is one of the reasons why they're betting long term on India. Does that not sort of blunt the attack?
Well, political reactions are not necessarily driven by what the rating agency's view is. It is one view. But on the ground, voting will happen on individual experiences, whether they feel hardship or they feel prosperity. For the BJP, this has come as a manna from heaven, in a sense, because everything that the Congress party and Rahul Gandhi had questioned is open to question. Whether if Moody says it's good, if ease of doing business has become better, if Pew Research says that he is the most popular leader, then what is Congress government arguing about? So the voter will have to examine both the viewpoints and address it depending on what his personal or her personal experience has been. The Moody's rating upgrade gives a feel-good factor for the economy. There's no doubt about it. Whether it is a political feel-good factor has to be assessed on what may transpire in the voting booth, in the polling booth, in the mind of the... And a lot of voters would have by now actually made up their minds on where they're headed on this. Remember that in the 2004 upgrade, BJP was in power. Vajpayee was in power. It's not just the India shining that derailed the BJP's campaign. Its allies went away. The Gujarat riots were in focus. A lot of factors come into play. So the Moody's upgrade is going to be one pixel in the whole picture. And it is a bright picture, and the BJP will leverage it to deflate the Congress's campaign.
Now, I just want to take that argument forward, and Praveen Chakravarti is also joining us now. Good evening, Praveen. If you can hear me, the argument is that Moody's upgrade will be one very small factor, but then looking at the fact that demonetization and GST have pretty much become two of the most important planks on which the Congress is trying to come back to power in Gujarat after 22 long years. They are riding on those two factors. And now you have a slew of foreign agencies who have sort of endorsed what the government has been doing economically and directionally. Does it not deflate that entire argument if you're basing that argument on the economics of it?
Yes, good evening. Okay, let's separate a couple of things here. See, as a policy economist and an analyst, I think it's a very good thing. We must welcome this ratings upgrade because it does open up a lot of opportunities for the economy that we can't fathom and quantify today. Now, I think this notion that this will somehow impact Gujarat elections, I think it's a bit far-fetched. One thing, as I said in the afternoon as well, is clear. Almost every Gujarati voter will now be told what Moody's agency is, what a sovereign rating means, and what does an upgrade mean. So to that extent, maybe there will be information awareness that'll be spread about the sovereign rating upgrade. But to argue that this will actually have an electoral impact, in fact, my own research using data and evidence has showed that forget sovereign ratings, GDP growth or even agriculture GDP growth or even inflation does not have a statistically significant impact on electoral choices. As that is to say, a positive GDP growth does not necessarily mean more voters will vote for you. As an incumbent ruling party. So I think it's extremely far-fetched to say that a sovereign rating agency's upgrade that actually means almost nothing to most people in general will impact elections in a state. This is extremely far-fetched.
Let me rephrase that question, Praveen, because I'm not saying that BJP will win more easily in Gujarat because of Moody's rating. My point is that what is the leg that the opposition has left to stand on now? What are they going and saying to voters now with such a strong counter in place?
I am no political campaign slogan writer or speech writer, but I mean, I think if we are, you know, looking for one, it's fairly evident, which is if the BJP went to town about this sovereign ratings upgrade, all that Rahul Gandhi and the Congress party has to do is turn it around and say, Modi bolta hai ache din, Moody's bolta hai ache din, aapke liye ache din aaye ya nahi, naukri hai ya nahi.
Okay, you know, that's a pretty good slogan for someone who says he's not a slogan writer, but
and for somebody who says he doesn't know Hindi.
that I won't say anything about. But Mr. Bhattacharya wants to come in. Mr.
Bhattacharya wants to come in. So, South India.
Yeah, you know, I'll tell you. I mean, you know, in response to your question on what can Congress do, I mean, you know, I'm not a Congress strategist here, but I'm just wondering. If you read the Moody's rating report on India, there are many talking points for the Congress in this report. For example, it does raise concerns over India's debt profile. And I think, if Congress were, and if BJP were to use this argument in a political campaign, in a speech making, using it as a speech making opportunity, as I was saying, then Congress will have a counter, and it will be a credible counter in terms of the debt dynamics, which is fairly fragile. As they said, that India's debt to GDP ratio is only 68% of GDP, and whereas the median rate for BA category countries is only 44%. So India's debt dynamics is not that safe, number one. Number two, the report also talks about how India needs to stay on the path of fiscal consolidation at a time when the government of India is thinking of fiscal stimulus and spending more money. And indeed, this current year, the fiscal deficit may actually be a stretch because of non-tax revenues falling dramatically by almost 35% in the first 6 months. So therefore, if the BJP were to use this as an election campaign point, my sense is Congress, if it is astute enough, will find a lot of points in the same Moody report to counter the BJP narrative. So that would be my sense, you know.
You know, that's an interesting point, Shankar, because we haven't really heard anything clear from the Congress as of today. On this day today, when the report has come out, there hasn't been any real clear counter. And as a serious political party, as the opposition and whose top leaders have been saying that the economy has been mishandled, don't you think that it is imperative that they come out and say their piece on this?
Well, one of two things must have happened. Either they are borrowing from Narasimha Rao's phraseology, not saying is also saying something. Or they're still wrapping their heads around on how to take this forward. I think the larger point that one must recognize is that politics is not driven by headlines or by what is the campaign material. Politics and electoral outcomes are defined by events. People will examine whether they're feeling better off or not. And this will only supplement those who feel that things are better off. And this will be rejected by those who don't feel better off. So those who are hurt by GST or DMO or whatever will have their own view. It's a binary debate. Are you better off or not?
But then in that case, I take you back to demonetization and the UP elections after that. I think there would it'd be difficult to find an Indian who was not affected by demonetization.
So what was the view of the voter? The view of the voter was that it was a good thing in the long run, that rich people who were evading taxes have been now fixed. And so that narrative played out in UP. UP was not just about demonetization. I think it will be completely erroneous for anybody to conclude that the UP elections were won on the back of demonetization. It was one of the factors. There was a lot of hard work done in structuring the vote bank by the BJP, in organizing the thing. And there is such a thing called a completely lost opposition. I mean, the Congress, when did it get its legs back? Is after the RBI report says 99% of money came back into the banking system. That's got them the win. Now this Moody's rating questions their questions. And it is up to the voters. You can't microanalyze this beyond a point. The question is, does the voter feel better off? Achhe din aaye ya nahi aaye? That will be the answer.
Okay, so Mr. Bhattacharya, you know, taking it forward in that context, if the Congress got its wind after 99% of the money came back after demonetization as per the RBI report, then you, of course, in the middle of all of this, you had the GDP numbers. You know, you had GST and whatever anecdotal evidence there was of its rollout being complex and difficult for people. All of that still holds true today, doesn't it? Despite the events the three events have talked about.
Yeah, you know, it's true. But, you know, Congress has a real tough task unless they make a conscious effort to change the narrative. Remember, on 30th November, the GDP numbers for Q2 will come out. And by all estimate, it seems that the GDP Q2 numbers may be a little better than the Q1 numbers. Now, if that happens, then you will not just have the Pew survey, you not just have the ease of doing business, you will have the Moody's rating, and you will have probably a better GDP number for Q2. So Congress really needs to devise a more attractive narrative to counter the BJP's economic slogans based on the four pieces of good news. So I think Congress must do that. And for example, from the Moody's rating itself, Congress has a lot of ammunition in this, in my view. For example, India's rating, you know, was A2, which is the third highest rating under Moody's in 1988, when the Congress was in power. The UPA government maintained India's investment grade rating of Baa3 for 12 years. Now, it is not that Congress doesn't have things to talk in a electoral battle or battle of debates. Now, unfortunately, what we are seeing of late is that the Congress has picked up its point after the RBI notes, 99% of the demonetized notes came back into the system. But I have a feeling that Congress is yet to build a strong enough narrative based on the available information in the public domain and counter the possible BJP strategy that it might employ in the Gujarat elections.
Yes, Shankar.
Simple thing about politics, it's not just about politics, it's about events. The Congress for 22 years has failed to put up an alternative face in Gujarat. And for the last so many years, what was the Modi campaign of 2014 about? It was juxtaposition of these are the problems and this is how we will solve them. The Congress is just about getting around to saying these are the problems, but they still don't have an answer on how they will solve it. They do not have an ideological plank. They do not have a policy plank. I think Congress has a lot of hard work to do.
Okay, so Praveen, if we take Gujarat elections out of the equation and just look at the narrative on the economy over the last few months, with the same events that Mr. Bhattacharya was talking about, the RBI report on how much money came back into the system, the GDP numbers, the overhang of demonetization then beginning to show, the GST rollout impact. Even looking at that narrative from a non-political point of view, do you think that enough has come in to change that mood in terms of the Moody ratings as well as ease of doing business?
No, in fact, I was going to say maybe I got onto the wrong show because it looks like we are all talking about how, we're all trying to act as script writers for the Congress party in terms of how to counter. I think I just have one simple point there, which is I think politically or electorally, this thing does not matter, period. Now, economically, we can talk about, the impact, what it means, all of those. And if I think your question is, will the Moody's ratings upgrade change things? There is something to be said about that. There's something to be said about sentiment. I think a lot of economic activity actually does depend on sentiment broadly. And the sentiment was dampened very heavily by what I think was largely self-inflicted with demonetization and poor implementation of GST. Perhaps there is a bit of a cheer to that overall negative and somber sentiment for the economy. Now, will that immediately translate into economic output? I do not think so. I think it is all said and done. The ratings upgrade is a good thing, like I said, but its impact is much more longer term, much more strategic in nature. So I don't think it has changed anything as far as the near-term economic indicators are concerned. Sure, we may see a GDP growth bounce back, but that's merely statistical. When it goes down to a low, it only bounces back. It's off of a low base, as we call it in statistical terms. So I think in near-term economic indicators, such as private investment, credit to industry, I don't think that's going to change dramatically because of this Moody's ratings upgrade.
Okay, the mood may change a bit because of Moody's. You've said a couple of times, Shankar, that politics is about events. Perhaps it's also about perception. And like Mr. Bhattacharya saying that if you have an improvement in GDP numbers towards the end of this month, that adds to the perception that the ruling party could build that demonetization was a good idea.
I think sentiments is a double-edged sword, so I won't run too long with it. I think what we must recognize is that the Moody's upgrade is a gift as Bloomberg Quint said in the morning, that it's early Christmas for Modi and Santa Claus has come and given a gift. I don't think we should read too much into it, and let's not look at the gift horse in the mouth.
Oh, all right, we'll leave it at that note. And of course, Shankar always has the best last words. So, Mr. Bhattacharya, Praveen, as well as Shankar Iyer, thank you so much. The Andy Mukherjee piece, which Shankar Iyer is referring to, is a must read. It's on the BloombergQuint.com website, where you can catch this show and others on the Moody upgrade, as well as the other top stories of the day. Keep tuned to BloombergQuint.com.